Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The 2-Hour Job Search, Using Technology to Get the Right Job Faster, 2nd Edition, by Steve Dalton. Narrated by Steve Dalton. Publisher's note. This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type The 2-Hour Job Search into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code CAREER and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. Diagrams, graphics, search bars, lists, boxes, charts, and the Quick Start Guide referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. In loving memory of my parents, Thomas and Dorothy Dalton. Introduction. Technological progress has merely provided us with more efficient means for going backwards. Aldous Huxley. I've heard numerous theories for why the job search is so difficult these days. Unresponsive employers, an uncertain economy, outsourcing, nepotism, poor work ethic, too much reality TV. During my decade and a half as a senior career coach and programming director at Duke University's Fuqua School of Business, I've helped people of all backgrounds, professions, and ages through the job search process. And I attribute its difficulty to something else entirely, technology. Technology has made our lives easier in so many ways, but it has only complicated the modern-day job search. Before internet job postings grew in popularity circa 2000, the job search was a simple, though tedious, process. Step 1, optional, find classified ads in newspaper. Step 2, mail resume and cover letter to potential employers. Step 3, wait for invitations to interview. That doesn't sound so bad, right? Ship out resumes and cover letters, and whoever is interested writes you back. Very straightforward. And believe it or not, it actually worked. Of course, those with connections to the potential employer still fared best, not having to rely on a piece of paper to make their first impression for them. However, cold calls by phone or mail were often all it would take to get an interview. Fast forward a couple of decades. The internet's in full swing, websites find relevant job postings for you, and resumes can be submitted online at any hour of the day. Although it's easier than ever before to find jobs, why does it now seem so much harder to actually get one? In short, technology made applying for jobs so efficient that hiring became inefficient. Technology effectively ruined the mail-and-wait job search strategy because it is now far more difficult for employers to pick out the few interesting applicants from the massive new influx of casual applicants. Applying for jobs used to require significant time and energy to search classified ads in your local paper, type and print cover letters and resumes, or CVs, depending on your profession and part of the world. I use the terms interchangeably in this book, on nice paper, and package them up in envelopes for mailing. Not everyone had that kind of spare time and energy, or money for that matter. Stationery and postage weren't cheap. And applying to any job required at least a minimal amount of research, heading to the library to find an address to mail your CV to, for example. With the internet, applying for a job can take less than a minute. Google a potential employer's name, click on the careers section of their website, and submit your information and resume. Done! When it's that easy, anyone can do it. And everyone does. Thus, recruiters who, before internet job postings, used to get a dozen or so applications in several weeks from mostly local candidates, now get hundreds or thousands from across the country within hours. Who has time to read hundreds of CVs? Recruiters today read resumes the way most of us read websites, ignoring a majority of what's on the page and skipping to the headlines of greatest interest. In the case of resumes, that usually means objective information like schools attended, previous employers, and job titles, if that. That's if hiring managers actually look at CVs received online in the first place. My students commonly describe online job postings as black holes, and I agree. Because there is no way for a hiring manager to read all those applications, the only fair thing to do is not read any of them. So they may avoid online applicants entirely. That this attitude saves a hiring manager many hours of additional work is hardly coincidental. Employers these days rely instead on internal referrals to decide whom to interview. Research backs this up. According to one study, for every one position the New York Federal Reserve filled with an online job posting applicant, they filled 12 through internal referrals. Put another way, every time you apply for a job online, not only are you hoping to be one of the handful of applicants employers choose to speak to out of the hundreds who apply, You're also hoping that it's the 1 in 13 that will be filled by an online applicant rather than an internal referral. The odds are nearly insurmountable. Pouring more hours into online applications is the equivalent of trying to pay your rent by buying even more lottery tickets. It may work once in a blue moon, but that doesn't make it a good approach. Getting internal referrals is simply the only predictable way to get interviews. Getting them efficiently is the core challenge of the modern job search. This book is effectively a speedrun approach for completing that core challenge. Speedrunning is a video gaming hobby where players record themselves trying to finish video games in world record times by combining world-class reflexes and concentration with a deep knowledge of quirks and vulnerabilities in each video game's programming. Interestingly, it is a communal process rather than a competitive one. Once one player identifies a new shortcut, every other player can now adopt that shortcut to improve their own times, further raising the bar. Similarly, this revised edition of the 2-Hour Job Search, 2HJS for short, is itself informed by the thousands of readers, users, and practitioners who read the original edition and contributed their own shortcuts to the process. In that sense, we are all now standing on the shoulders of giants. And by considering the steps outlined in this book, you are joining a community that is eager to share their own best practices for this process with you. Before we proceed further, a quick disclaimer. The titular 2 hours refers to the amount of time it takes to lay the groundwork for your process, not the totality of your job search. That said, once your foundation is in place, the remaining steps in your search become seamless, almost automatic. More on that later. Now let's finish discussing why online job postings make a speedrun approach to networking necessary in the first place. The resume black hole. I first met Becca, not her real name, in late March, a very high-stress time for many students. Campus recruiting is ended by then, so students without jobs at that point tend to panic. Their May graduation date is looming, and they realize that continuing to avoid the inherently rejection-heavy off-campus search is no longer an option. Like most of her peers, Becca had assumed she would find her job while still on campus. She'd been at the top of her class her whole life, after all. But she hadn't found it, having underestimated the number and caliber of her competitors. She was so anxious that she canceled her spring break trip with a group of her classmates in order to focus on her job search. Months later, she would call these spring break efforts a garbage-in, garbage-out job search. Becca spent her week off scanning job posting websites, hoping to find the perfect job. She was frustrated by the fact that all the interesting positions she found required candidates to have several years of previous relevant experience, which she lacked. But she hoped the strength of her resume would convince potential employers to give her a chance. In one last gasp on her last night of break, she spent 8 consecutive hours surfing job postings and submitting resumes to dozens of employers. She never heard back from a single one. Online job postings are not inherently evil, nor was Becca being lazy by applying for so many jobs online. Quite the opposite, actually. She was simply following the same old mail-and-wait paradigm her parents did, except electronically rather than with stamps and envelopes. It felt like progress, so she decided to invest as much time as she could into that approach rather than risk wasting time by experimenting with other approaches. This strategy is also known as satisficing. Satisfice is a hybrid word formed from satisfy and suffice. Coined by Nobel Prize-winning social scientist Herbert Simon in 1956, the term describes a person's tendency to select the first available solution that meets a given need rather than an optimal solution. Believe it or not, satisficing is actually a good strategy in a majority of cases. It's what prevents us from spending hours deciding which of the dozens of hand soaps to buy at the grocery store. The alternative to satisficing is maximizing. Maximizing means finding the best possible choice, regardless of the amount of time or effort it takes. For major purchases like a house, erring on the side of maximizing rather than satisficing makes good sense. But in most cases, satisficing, well, satisfices. Hiring managers are classic satisficers, which makes total sense. Their ability to make outstanding hiring decisions rarely, if ever, factors into how big their raise is at the end of the year. Therefore, they'll want to spend as little time making hiring decisions as possible. For them, finding a good enough candidate quickly is better than finding a perfect candidate slowly. So their hiring decision is very unlikely to involve reviewing hundreds of resumes. The fundamental flaw in Becca's satisficing strategy was that she was satisficing on the wrong need. She satisficed on the feeling of making progress rather than on actually making progress. To be fair, the latter is much more difficult, and the route for how to do so is very unclear. Thus, many people make this error. But, unfortunately, just because something hurts doesn't make it exercise. I call this phenomenon the defensive job search, DJS. Job searching for stats and validation rather than efficacy. The DJS is ubiquitous and hard to quit, but quitting it is an essential first step to a successful job search. No matter how diligently or efficiently Becca employed a defensive job search, pushing out resumes and cover letters to employers through online job postings, she was unlikely to succeed. The defensive job search. Keeping morale up during a job search is very difficult due to lack of positive reinforcement. The most important positive reinforcement, a job offer, comes at the very end of the process when it is no longer needed. Until then, the only sources of it are, "Congratulations, your application has been successfully submitted," when succumbing to a job posting black hole, and, "We know you're doing your best, honey," from your loved ones. However, getting the latter often requires being able to quantify your effort in an understandable way. The two most accepted measures for doing so are, 1, the number of online applications completed, and 2, the number of hours spent searching through postings. Unfortunately, neither of these correlates strongly with success. However, without knowing how to credibly achieve job search success, job seekers are being rational when they continue to pursue the achievable goal of affirmation, even if doing so is counterproductive to their actual goal. This is the defensive job search. In the DJS, job seekers prioritize visible efforts over results. Again, it is rational behavior, since the former is in your control and the latter is not. Scientists estimate that 70% of people feel what's called imposter syndrome, where we worry that others will find out we're not really as talented as they think we are. If you've ever felt imposter syndrome when job searching, please know that this uncertainty is not your fault. You have likely never been formally trained to job search, at least not in the same way that you were trained in algebra or grammar. The good news is that a little bit of training goes a long way. What I teach in this book is the opposite of the DJS. You will do very little applying online, and you'll only spend an hour or so strategically searching through job postings. Giving up these defensible effort metrics for success metrics, like your number of informational meetings, which we address in part 3 of this book, may seem uncomfortable at first, but you'll soon be more productive and confident in your search. And your loved ones will soon learn to make that shift as well. Technology in this case had, as Aldous Huxley said, only given job seekers a more efficient means for going backward. It simplified the application process to the point of ruin, drowning out the qualified candidates, who used to be willing to take the time and effort required to apply via the postal mail method, as they had good odds of success, among many unqualified candidates, who didn't bother to apply when the process was costly, but applied in droves once those time and effort costs were removed. Mail and wait simply wasn't designed for the explosion in internet-aided applicants. Technology also gave job search expertise a more efficient means for going backward. The struggle for clicks and views in a crowded job search advice market incentivized output rather than curation, further overwhelming already inundated job seekers with new books, articles, resumes, and tips. However, every additional piece of advice comes at a cost. In his book, The Paradox of Choice, psychologist Barry Schwartz discusses a study in which participants were allowed to select a free Godiva chocolate. Some were allowed to choose from a box of 6, and others from a box of 30. The surprising finding was that those who chose from the box of 6 were actually happier with their decision than those who had more to choose from. This can be attributed to a concept called decision anxiety. When picking from a box of 6 chocolates, making the right choice is relatively easy. You either like nuts or you don't. You prefer dark chocolate to milk or white, and so on. However, in a box of 30, you have only 1 in 30 odds of making the optimal choice. You may be tempted to examine each chocolate before making your choice, hopefully without touching them, losing time as well. You may even feel stressed after eating your chocolate, when you wonder whether you should have chosen differently. Similarly, a job seeker has to take time, sometimes just seconds and other times minutes or hours, to decide which articles to read and which approaches to implement. These distractions tax both our speed and our willpower. Welcome to modern job searching. It is by far the single most important subject you were never taught in school. I myself was blindsided by how poorly equipped I was for the modern job search, even after attending every workshop conducted by both my undergraduate and graduate career centers. Campus recruiting was consistently successful for me, leading me to my dream job in marketing. However, a few months into the job I'd spent my whole life planning for, my boss pulled me aside and told me, "Steve, marketing may not be the right career for you." I was devastated. After the shock and denial wore off, I saw she was spot on in her assessment. The job routinely minimized my strengths and accentuated my weaknesses, frustrating me so thoroughly that I dreaded the sound of my own alarm clock every morning. Since I no longer had access to campus recruiting, I decided to look online for an organizational plan that outlined how to conduct my very first off-campus job search. However, click after click, all I could find were laundry lists of tips rather than a coherent process. Even worse, the laundry lists tended to feature terrible cliches like put yourself out there, use your contacts, or go to a local career fair, adding irony to injury since those largely disappeared with the advent of online job postings. The reason I hate such careless advice is because, although it was delivered in optimistic and inspirational tones, it gave no consideration whatsoever to the limited amount of spare time and pain tolerance I actually had. As Barry Schwartz himself said in The Paradox of Choice, when we are given too many choices, choice no longer liberates, it debilitates. It might even be said to tyrannize. Even while unemployed, I wouldn't have the time to trial and error my way through all that advice. And even if somehow I did, following tips like wear a t-shirt that says please hire me into an interview, actual advice I read, would save me the worry of ever being employed again. That said, there is no way around the fact that the only way to get internal referrals is through networking. Personally, I hate networking. I find strangers intimidating. I'm terrible with names and worse with faces, and believe it or not, I never learned how to be charming in my chemical engineering classes. However, I simply had to find a way to compensate for this limitation. I wanted instructions for doing that, not advice. But nothing of the sort seemed to exist. That is what I bring you in this book, a process I've struggled daily to refine over 2 decades and thousands of iterations. For the lucky minority of you who feel no anxiety at all about networking, know firstly that I'm incredibly jealous. Know secondly that you'll still get a lot of value from reading this book based on what I've heard from past 2HJS users in your camp. Taking a couple of hours to learn to structure, prioritize, and systemize your natural abilities will ensure you get the best possible outcome with the least possible effort. The low-tech, low-tact approach. Another student I worked with, whom I will call Vivek, had unfortunately come to my attention before we had even met. He had made waves among both his classmates and his recruiters for his aggressiveness. Vivek wanted to become a strategy consultant with and only with an elite firm, and he was incredibly focused in his efforts. He would attend every event this handful of firms sponsored, meet every representative the company sent, and unfailingly send them thank you notes the next day. So far, so good. Regrettably, although his networking skills in the moment were mostly correct, his overall strategy was not. Vivek was so desperate to sell himself that he ended up talking more than he listened, veering away from genuine relationship building into transparently transactional and quantity-based networking, a common mistake among those who focus on too small a universe of firms. One of my former classmates, now a recruiter for one of those elite firms, called me after one of their events to catch up. And before hanging up, he gingerly asked me, "By the way, do you know Vivek?" Uh-oh. Apparently, he had remembered Vivek monopolizing his time at their event, and winced when he saw an informational meeting request from him a few days later. Informational meetings, or informational interviews, are conversations where people answer job seekers' questions and/or pre-screen them for an interview. Used correctly, informational meetings are also the most efficient way to acquire internal referrals. We cover them in detail in Part 3. Just as my classmate feared he would, Vivek used that meeting to ask tedious questions like those he had asked in person just a week before. This could have been forgivable had Vivek not also requested similar conversations on the same day with several other recruiters from that event. As expected, Vivek did not get an offer from his top choice firms. They found him well qualified but overzealous, making them uncomfortable about putting him in front of clients. Vivek was devastated and spent. He stopped job searching for nearly a month as he mentally recovered from watching his entire strategy collapse. Vivek was correct in identifying the importance of creating personal relationships with recruiters, but he didn't use the technology available to him to diversify his efforts or manage his follow-up effectively, smothering those he sought to impress. Technologies like job search engines and social networking have unlocked a totally new, highly efficient way to job search, but it requires forgetting most of what you've learned before. Mail and wait as a strategy is obsolete, but so too is the concept of selling yourself. The key to today's job search is a mix of high and low tech. Specifically, using technology to efficiently locate a living, breathing advocate for you within your target employers. That is what this book will help you do. Networking is simply another way to say, acquire internal referrals who will help get you job interviews. And adding that bit of specificity to a vague yet critical concept makes it solvable. 2HJS works because it applies the Pareto principle to the job search, focusing on only what you need to know rather than on all the things you possibly could know. The Pareto principle, more commonly known as the 80-20 rule, states that in most situations, 80% of one's results can be attributed to 20% of one's actions. It is named for Italian economist Vilfredo Pareto, who noted in 1906 that 80% of Italy's land was owned by 20% of its population, and that 80% of his garden's peas came from 20% of his pea pod plants, though that may just be urban legend. Interesting, but how does that concept get put to practical use? In the business world, it can be used to prioritize efforts. In 2002, Microsoft's then-CEO Steve Ballmer acknowledged that 80% of crashes in Windows and Office were due to only 20% of the program's bugs. The programmers could have spread their time equally among all known issues in a quest for perfection, a maximizing approach. Alternatively, they could have addressed the easiest errors first to show quick results to investors and consumers, a satisficing approach. However, both of these strategies would have had less impact than their chosen path, which was to focus on the most disruptive 20% of issues first. Some of the less disruptive issues were likely never solved, surprising no Apple fans whatsoever, because entirely new versions of the software were soon released, rendering the remaining repairs unnecessary. The job search is no different. There are immeasurable opportunities to be distracted by unnecessary details, and it takes discipline to stay focused. Most of my job seekers are so busy that they have only a couple of hours a week to devote to their search. So for them, achieving a high degree of efficiency is essential. 2HJS teaches readers a formal job search process that ensures they benefit from the 80-20 rule at every step. It's not only for current students or first-time job seekers either. It works for experienced professionals looking to change jobs mid-career, for military veterans transitioning into the civilian world, and for individuals who have been laid off or otherwise out of work no matter the length of time. With all of the readily available information and technology, it's easier for job seekers to build relationships and identify targets. This process has no barriers to entry, It can be done just as well by someone without an advanced degree or a single LinkedIn contact as by one who has multitudes of each. In its simplest form, the job search of today requires three distinct steps: prioritize, contact, and convince. And each step gets its own in-depth treatment in this book. It is essential to prioritize, part one, before embarking on a job search. Otherwise, the infinite information available online becomes overwhelming and impossible to navigate. Once targets have been identified, you need to initiate contact, part two, before you can secure any advocacy. Once a sympathetic contact is listening, you can convince, part three, them to be your ally. Consider prioritizing and contacting to be the tickets to launching your job search. These two steps will take up exactly 2 hours of your time. The next step, convincing, is an ongoing investment that will vary with each employer, but helpful time estimates are provided. In 2HJS, you'll know exactly what to do every single day once you wake up, and it will rarely amount to more than 30 minutes of effort. In fact, many days will require no job search effort whatsoever, giving you some well-deserved days off. Lastly, it's important to note that this book is not a comprehensive job search guide. Such a book would be quite lengthy and mostly unnecessary, much like buying a travel guide to all of South America when you plan to visit only Peru. This book's single-minded focus is to get you interviews as efficiently and quickly as possible. Taking a step back, here's a summary of the major steps of the job search process and where this book fits in. Choose what you want to do. Write a resume and cover letter. Prioritize target employers. Contact target employers. Convince advocates to provide internal referrals. Interview. Negotiate an offer. The 2HJS starts you at the point after you broadly identify what you want to do, and it ends once you secure formal interviews with your target employers. For a similarly efficiency-minded approach to choosing a career, writing a resume, and developing interview skills, visit 2hourjobsearch.com to find more information on my follow-up book, The Job Closer. Note that there is technology that I do not discuss in this audiobook. There is no shortage of interesting job search technology out there, but that doesn't mean all of it is useful and/or necessary. 2HJS strives to be right tech rather than high tech, because cool isn't always helpful, and can often be quite the opposite. This book's mission isn't to impress you with all that technology can do. Its mission is to help you harness well-established technology to make this process as pain-free, efficient, and effective as possible. Within 2 hours, starting from scratch, you will be done for the day. Any further time would be unnecessary, but any less time would be insufficient. Thus, the 2-hour job search. Since 2008, I've taught this job search speed-running process to every student who passes through Fuqua. But I recognize that not everyone has the means, desire, or opportunity to attend a major business school. That is why I consider my work developing and sharing the 2HJS job search process to be a moral obligation, since the vast majority of humanity's job searches are experienced far away from a university's friendly confines. Similarly, while I originally built this process to help people seek jobs in business, it's proved useful to job seekers of all kinds, from programmers to engineers to creatives and beyond, with two notable exceptions: doctors and academics. While some elements of this book are still useful in those searches, for example, how to manage informational meetings, hiring decisions in those two areas tend to involve unique in-house processes and personalities. For those of you pursuing roles in academia in particular, I highly recommend Karen Kelsky's The Professor Is In, which very much shares this book's ethos of bringing concrete structure to an inherently ambiguous process. Finally, after hundreds of iterations of teaching this material, I found that my audiences frequently ask the same questions in a similar order each time. Therefore, each chapter is set up in a similarly ordered question and answer format to help you follow along and digest the material. The end of every chapter features a troubleshooting section covering a few of the most commonly encountered challenges, along with instructions for navigating each one. In terms of what you need on your end to follow my process, please make sure you have access to a spreadsheet software like Microsoft Excel, an email program with an integrated calendar like Outlook or Gmail, and a LinkedIn profile. I'm happy to say that both Becca's and Vivek's stories have happy endings. After working with me to learn how to execute his own 2-hour job search, Vivek secured an internship with a boutique consulting firm. Becca received a full-time brand manager offer from a Midwestern food company. Becca's story didn't quite end there, however. Through her 2HJS investigations, she came to realize that she found human resource management more appealing than pure marketing. So she declined her brand management offer. I asked whether she wanted to meet me for help with restarting her search, and she told me, "Thank you, but I know what I'm doing now." That comment still makes me smile. LinkedIn Startup. LinkedIn is a free professional social networking site, and it proves very useful at various points in the 2-hour job search. Create a profile now, you will need it later, by registering at linkedin.com and supplying basic objective information about your prior/current employers and education. Filling out your profile more completely than that, for example, with subjective descriptions of each position held, can take several hours, but that is not critical to this process and you can skip it until your outreach has been initiated. To get started, search for your favorite and/or most popular coworker, boss, friend, and family member, and invite each of them to connect to you. This gives LinkedIn's technology an idea of who else is in your social network, and it will suggest people you may also want to connect to from there. Once your initial contacts accept your invitation, their networks are notified that you've joined LinkedIn, so that others will start reaching out to you. Thus, with no further effort of your own, your online network builds in the background. This gives you a great foundation for when we more actively engage LinkedIn in Chapter 5. Part 1. Prioritize. The Lamp List. Chapter 1. List. 40 minutes. Quick Start Exercise Number 1. Identifying Dream Employers. Take the next 60 seconds and write down as many ideal employers as you can, particularly the ones that led you to this audiobook in the first place. Don't worry about whether these employers are logical or whether you're qualified to work for them. Just worry about whether you'd actually accept a job from them in your field or fields of interest if one were offered to you. If you are currently in school, write down employers that you wish had come to campus to recruit you. Once this 60 seconds is up, set this list aside. Note that it does not matter whether you wrote down 2 or 10 employers. As long as you started a list, you succeeded. When we revisit this list shortly, it will give you a critical head start on the first step of the process. And congratulations! Your 2-hour job search experience is already underway. What is a lamp list? The lamp list, list, advocacy, motivation, posting, is a systematic and efficient 70-minute process for making a prioritized list of target employers. Don't be intimidated, however, as no individual step takes longer than 15 minutes to complete, making it easy to start and stop as time permits. The critical goal of the lamp list is to end up with a prioritized, finite target list of at least 40 employers that is precisely ordered based on 3 pieces of data that are both easy to find and predictive of success. The precise ordering is important so that you know exactly which target employers are best worth your spare time and energy at any given moment. Why make a list? And why do I need so many employers in the list? The list of at least 40 employers is essential for moving beyond the usual suspects, employers who tend to attract the most attention from job seekers, either in your local area or, if you're geographically flexible, more globally, and thus have the highest amount of competition and lowest odds of success. That's not to say the usual suspects are bad targets. They're great targets, especially given how highly motivating they often tend to be. But fixating only on the usual suspects tends to turn out badly with remarkable predictability. Let's take a look at some national numbers for the U.S., keeping in mind that what's going on in the U.S. nationally is also indicative of what's going on in your local region. In 2018, there were 16 million businesses in the United States, and 165 million jobs were had between those employers. Of those jobs, nearly two-thirds were with employers with fewer than 100 employees. Those employers with over 100 people may be the first ones that come to mind, but they make up just 1.3% of available employers, and between them, they account for just over one-third of all employment in the U.S. The remaining 98.7% of employers offer paychecks just like the largest 1.3% do. But too often I see job seekers either ignore them or refuse to consider them because their names are unfamiliar, effectively eliminating two-thirds of available job opportunities without a second or really even a first thought. Furthermore, that 98.7% of employers are the ones with the least competition for spots simply because they do not have household names. In most cases, employers with under 100 employees would be quite happy with good enough talent who are proactive and make it easy for the employer to hire them. This especially includes job seekers who lack directly relevant work experience, ideal work references, or a steady timeline of work over the years. Because there are now databases that allow job seekers to find these 16 million employers, it is more important than ever to identify a subset that is of particular interest before you begin in order to avoid being overwhelmed by the possibilities. On the flip side, if your search is geographically restricted, it's tempting to focus on the only employers in town. However, note that no town has a single employer, not even Bentonville, Arkansas, home of megacorporation Walmart, nor Los Alamos, New Mexico, where 38% of the city's 12,000 residents work for the Los Alamos National Laboratory. Other employers must spring up to support these organizations. Granted, if you're a nurse and there's only one hospital in the area, a regrettable market situation that economists call monopsony. In monopolies, there is only one seller of a good or service, but in monopsonies, there's only one buyer. This may involve either leaving your profession, temporarily or otherwise, starting your own business, or a reluctant move to a city with more opportunities. None are ideal options, but in limited geography situations, it is even more important to identify your alternatives before beginning your search, since in-town lower-wage roles can actually result in a higher net income and overall life satisfaction than professional roles that require hours-long commutes each way. Note, regardless of whether your search is local or remote, most informational meetings conducted using 2HJS will be by phone or Zoom, since many contacts will prefer this to meeting in person with a stranger. So, whether your job search is local or countrywide, the technology you use will be the same. By creating a list of employers, we are essentially drawing the borders of our job search, taking an intimidating and infinite-seeming job search universe and turning it into something pleasantly finite. This makes filling in the three lamp list data points for those employers a self-contained, minimally stressful activity, just like coloring the pictures in a coloring book. A good example of how making a list of target employers is effective can be found in an unlikely source, reality television. On ABC's The Bachelor, 25 women are isolated in a house and given a chance to form a relationship with one eligible bachelor. Based on the bachelor's preferences, one or more women are eliminated each episode until only one winner remains. And voila, romance blossoms for a couple of weeks. The genders are reversed in the show's equally salacious spinoff, The Bachelorette. We'll stick to The Bachelor in this discussion for simplicity. Watching this show physically pains me. I have a very low tolerance for awkwardness, which for a career coach is like being a doctor with a latex allergy. But I've always found its game theory fascinating. Who wouldn't be a good bachelor if you limited supply and maximized demand like that? I mean, the guy has a 100% chance of winning. His entire strategy consists of get my own TV show. On the flip side, being a female contestant on The Bachelor is an awful proposition. Supply is artificially restricted, and demand is artificially inflated. Each woman has just 1 in 25 odds of winning, and she also foregoes a month or so of normal dating activity, and perhaps a job as well, in order to play. And she hasn't even seen the guy. It's dehumanizing and a long shot at best, so who would do such a thing? Sadly, every year I see dozens of very smart people do exactly this. Voluntarily subject themselves to situations with high competition and low odds of success in the form of online job postings, desperately hoping someone gives them a chance. There are numerous downsides to this approach, but the worst of all is the toll it takes on one's confidence. I have seen people who've lived their whole lives at the top of their class be shaken by the epic silence after submitting to an online job posting, to the point where they'd be willing to accept anything just to make the anxiety stop. This is not an attractive look to employers. Shocking, right? Employers are excellent at detecting which candidates have other active prospects and which do not. Many will even ask directly during interviews where else job seekers are interviewing, and they have a strong preference for those with richer prospects. They assume that how a job seeker approaches their job search is predictive of how they'll approach their job. Is this the type of candidate who puts all their eggs in one basket and hopes their lack of contingency planning will never come to light? Or is this the type of candidate who creates a strategy and backup plans for if, really when, events don't go as planned? If you were the interviewer, which kind of candidate would you prefer to hire? There's a certain confidence and serenity that accompanies job seekers who have other options in process when they speak with an employer. They don't need any single interview to work out since they have other prospects waiting in the wings. But for the latter group, those attributes are impossible to simulate. A desperate job seeker really needs every single interview to work out since there are usually no others on the horizon to take the pressure off. Those job seekers essentially go from one season of The Bachelor to the next, starting from scratch each time an opportunity doesn't work out. Wouldn't an employer prefer a candidate who considers them their dream employer, though? Yes, of course. Just not at the expense of practicality. Identifying a dream employer is not a valid excuse for shunning all others. Furthermore, and this is a common theme throughout the book, you can't control outcomes, you can only control process. Good process yields good outcomes, yes. However, because you never make the final hiring decision, there is simply no way to guarantee a positive outcome. Just like there is no way to guarantee any single coin flip comes up tails, and no way for a contestant to ensure the Bachelor picks her. So, what can we do about it? Let's stick with the Bachelor analogy a bit longer. In game theory terms, a contestant could employ two methods to improve her chance of winning. Increase the odds of the game, say, finding a dating show on which only 10 women compete rather than 25. Or, increase the number of times the game can be played. An even better approach, however, is to become the Bachelor himself. Collect a large number of preliminary candidates, narrow them down by collecting key pieces of information about each one, and focus primarily on the strongest prospects. That is effectively what the lamp list does for job seekers. Why make a lamp list specifically? The lamp list allows for efficient gathering of specific, useful employer information, providing black and white data for choosing which employers to approach and in what order. LAMP guarantees efficiency in two main ways. It ensures that similar tasks are grouped together to save time, and that each task is carried out with the appropriate level of detail, and no more. It accomplishes this by limiting research to three pieces.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.